Hi everyone. So I'm Arthur Rekha and I'll be talking about our joint work together with Thomas Falconet on complexity in tree algebras. So complexity is a new tool we've been developing for some time that allows us to analyze more precisely what happens into tree algebras. And here, more precisely, I'll be presenting you this new tool and I also present our first results on what we call bounded complexity. So let's get started. Algebras are used to characterize classes of languages. So this is well known, and in particular, algebra can mean monoids or finite semigroups in the case of finite words. And in this case, to characterize means to obtain such a result as, so for instance, there's Schützenberger theorem from 1955. It says that a regular language is star-free if and only if its syntactic monoid is aperiodic. So there are other algebras and such characterization results for other structures, such as infinite words, with, for instance, vehicle algebras or omega semigroups, and also for structures that are not linear, such as trees or graphs. So in this case, you have breakloans, hyperploans, H-algebras, VR-algebras, and so on. However, some of these algebras, the particularity, and it is that they are infinitely sorted, meaning that there is an infinity of carrier sets. So these different sets may be used for different reasons, and most of the time it's to allow or disallow some operations. So I'll be talking about that later, in the case of tree algebras. But for now, I just want to remark that there's some inherent problem with these algebras, it's that it's hard to derive characterizations with infinitely sorted algebras. So this is not an a priori statement, it's just that that's what experience shows. We don't have many such results, or for what we have, there are simpler results. And our objective with complexity is to characterize classes that can be naturally defined using infinitely sorted algebras. So let's look at such an algebra that we call FT sigma algebras, where sigma is some ranked set, and this algebra describes infinite describe finite trees. So the free such algebra has a carrier sets TX for all X where X is a finite set of variables, and TX here is just a set of all trees in which all the variables of X appear on the leaves. So let's take a look at a few examples of objects that are in TX. So for instance here, we have this tree A, B, C. There is no variable in this tree, only three letters, A, B, and C. So it is in the sort T empty set. For this second tree, A, X, X, we have one variable X that appears twice. Anyway, it is still in the sort TX. And for this third tree, A, X, Y, then we have two variables n and x, y, so it is in sort txy. Now that we have defined these objects, we can define operations on them. And the first one is substitution. So if we have some tree here with variable x, then we can substitute this other tree into x with this operation dot x. And the resulting tree is just here. So here you had x, and it's been replaced here on the right by ABC. And that's how we define substitution. Now for third operation, which is renaming. If you have some renaming of the variables here, sigma that maps x and y to x, for instance, then it induces an operation on trees with these variables. So here, this tree AXY is mapped by 2AXX. And this is all for the operations of this free algebra. So now let's talk about finite algebra. So here, what we mean by a finite algebra is an infinite series of finite carrier sets AX, where the AXs are indexed by finite sets of variables X. And together with these carrier sets, we have some operations. The first one is not really an operation, but a way to define constants. So for each variable, each letter A in the alphabet sigma, which is of arity n, if we fix some variables xi from x0 to xn minus 1, then we can define A of x0, x1, xn minus 1, which will be an element of sort A x0, x1, xn minus 1. We can also define the analog of substitution in this case, which is this operation that goes from sort AX and AY to AX minus X union Y, where little x is some variable in this big X. So this is really just substitution in the case of finite algebras with the sort described. Now for renaming, if we have some map sigma that goes from X to Y, then it defines an operation rename sigma that goes from sort X to sort Y. Note here that we have this this hypothesis that sigma is surjective. So this is to respect our condition in the free algebra that the sort X corresponds to trees in which all the variables of X appear on the leaves. Okay. Now that we have defined these operations and this sort, so we still need identities, because we need identities in algebra. For one way, it's associativity, for instance. So here we could list some of these identities, but it would be a bit hard. It can be done, but it's easier to think in terms of expressions. So here, using our operations, we can write some expressions here using them. For instance, axy.yb or axz.zb. In this case, these two expressions denote the same tree in the free algebra. So this means that we must evaluate to the same element in a finite algebra. And this is how we define our identities. For such a structure as what we just described to be the finite tree algebra, it must satisfy the condition that if we take two expressions that evaluate to the same tree, then they must evaluate to the same element. And finally, we also define morphisms and congruence in the standard way. And now we have this result that says that there is a unique morphism that goes from the free algebra to some finite algebra A. And we call it the evaluation morphism of A. So why is it unique? It's because we fix the value of the constants. Then using induction, we get such a unique morphism. Using these algebras, we can now define languages. Still, this is a standard definition here. So a language L of finite trees over the alphabet sigma is recognized by a finite algebra if there is a set P in the sort A empty set, such that L is the inverse image of P under the evaluation morphism. So here, note that P is taken into sort A empty set, and that is because our language of trees does not contain trees with variables. Well, we can look at a first example. So let L be the language of all trees that only contain A's and B's. We want to design an algebra that recognizes this language. So here, if we have some tree here, A, X, X, we want to remember what are the letters that appear in this algebra, in this tree. So here, we only need to remember the set that only contains A. We also need to know that there are X's in this tree. But here, it's already here, because we are in sort A, X, we know that X is the only variable. So we know all the things that appear in this tree. There is an A, and there are X's. Now, for the operations. For the X sort, here it's just the set of all parts of sigma, and this for all X. Now if you have some tree whose set of letters is A and another tree whose set of letters is B, and you plug the second tree into the first one at variable X, then you get a tree whose letters will be A union B. So this is how we defined our substitution operation. I don't write anything here for renaming, because renaming does not change anything on these elements. So renaming here will be the identity. And using that, we have described a finite algebra. Here, notice that the size of sort X is 2 to the size of sigma. And so it's bounded, it is constant, it does not depend on the size of x. So why am I saying that? Because it could in a marginal case. So let's look at another example, which is the language of trees without bees on the leftmost branch. So once again, we want to define an algebra that recognizes this language. Look at this first tree on the left. On the leftmost branch, you can read A, B, C. And because we're interested in the leftmost branch, this is what we will remember. On the leftmost branch, we can read A, B, and C. Now, if we look at another tree here on the right, there is AAX. So here, once again, we can remember the letters that appear on this leftmost branch. There are only A's. But here, I also need to remember this variable X. Why is that? Well, it's because we need to remember this variable if we want to define substitution in a correct way. Here, for instance, imagine I plug my tree on the left into this variable x. Then on the leftmost branch, I will read A, 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 B, C. So in the end, I will read A, B, C on my leftmost branch. However, if I plug it into y, I will, on my leftmost branch, there will only be A, A, X. And it won't have changed anything. So if I don't remember this variable, I can't know what the result should be. That's why I need to remember it. In this case, the sort AX is defined as a disjoint union of the parts of sigma with pairs of parts of sigma and element of X. So here, the size of AX is a constant plus a constant times the size of X. So in this case, the size of sort AX is linear in the size of X. And to this is the basic idea behind complexity. The size of AX may depend on the size of X. To formalize this definition, we define the complexity. So given some finite algebra A with Carrier sets AX, we define its complexity map to be the map C of A that maps the size of X to the size of AX. So here, notice that this is well defined. Because if I take two sets of variables X and Y that have the same size, and this means that there is a bijection between the both of them, and using our renaming operation, we then get a bijection between sort AX and sort AY. So this complexity map is well defined. So now, formally, if we look again at our first example, the size of X was constant, and according to our definition, the complexity map will be constant, and more particularly, this complexity map will be bounded. So we say that this algebra has bounded complexity. And in the second example here, it was linear. So we say that our algebra has linear complexity. More generally, we could talk about polynomial complexity, exponential complexity, and so on. So let's look now at the last example, which is the language of all trees with at least a B on every branch. So here we have two trees. Look first at this tree on the left. On the leftmost branch, there are four branches. So the first one you read ABX, and the second ABC, and the third and fourth you read AAY. In this case, for the first two branches, there's already a B on these branches. So there's nothing to do here. However, for the two last branches, there is no B. So this means that we will need to plug some subtree that contains a B into Y if we hope that our tree will be accepted by the algebra. So here we will remember that there are variables Y where for which there is no B above. We need to remember this set of variables. For this tree on the right, the situation is quite similar. So here on the left branch, there is no B. So this X will need to get a B. And here, these two Ys will also need to get some B. So we remember this pair XY. However, here, if you look at this branch AAC, this branch is complete. It does not end with a variable, but with a constant. And there is no B on the branch. So this means that if I only plug into the variables, my tree will be rejected by the algebra. So here I need to remember that this is why I have this bottom symbol. And this is also why in here on the left, where this problem did not exist, I had a top symbol. So here, the sort AX would be defined by the product of the parts of X together with top and bottom. And we then would get an algebra of size 2 to the size of X times 2, which is exponential. So this algebra has exponential complexity. Notice now that we can also define this language L with top-down deterministic automaton with two states, a state no and a state yes. So here we change to state yes when we meet a B while reading our branch. And actually, if you have any language that is recognized by a top-down deterministic automaton, then it can be this automaton can be translated into an algebra that has exponential complexity using similar constructions. And this means that any language recognized by a top-down deterministic automata is recognized by an algebra of exponential complexity. So this is interesting because I won't go into details, but you can test yourself if you want, but it's not possible with polynomial complexity. And as such, this first interesting property of complexity. But what does complexity mean at the end? Well, for bounded complexity, the algebra does not remember anything about the variables. The only thing you can remember if you are in sort AX is that the variables that appear in the tree are exactly X, and that's it. For polynomial complexity, you can remember a bit more. So here, for instance, suppose your sort AX is X to the K. This means you can remember K variables, and this is polynomial. And here, if you remember our example that was linear before our second example, we remembered what was happening on one particular branch. So here we can just do that with K branches. So this is something that we can do with polynomial complexity. For exponential complexity, now if you have a sort x which is k to the x, then this means that you can remember a function that goes from x to k, which is, for instance, if k is 2, a set of variables. Or if k is z over qz, then you can do modulo counting, and this way you can count how many times some variables appear. But using that, you can also count the number of letters for a particular letter in your tree. So this is something, again, that you could not do with polynomial complexity or bounded complexity. Now, for doubly exponential complexity, we have a more interesting result, which is the following. If you take a top-down non-deterministic automaton, then it can be transformed into an algebra of doubly exponential complexity that recognizes the same language. And conversely, any language recognized by a finite algebra is regular. So that means that our hierarchy of complexity classes stops at doubly exponential, and doubly exponential exactly corresponds to the regular languages. So this is yet again an interesting point for complexity. But this is just doubly exponential complexity, and what about bounded, polynomial, or exponential complexity? Are these classes meaningful? Well, to answer this question, we investigated bounded complexity, and we asked this question: what are the languages recognized by algebras of bounded complexity? And well, we proved the characterization of such results. And first, to do that, we proved the characterization of algebras of bounded complexity. So let's look at this result. Consider for all x the group morphism induced by renaming phi x. So you start with some renaming phi sigma in the symmetric group of x, and you map it to the operation rename sigma, which is in the symmetric group of ax. Then we proved this result of invariance under commutation. It says that the finite syntactic algebra is of bounded complexity if and only if, for all sufficiently large finite sets x, the kernel of phi x is exactly the entire symmetric group. So that means that whenever x is large, in a bounded in an algebra of bounded complexity, then the elements are invariant under renaming, under permutations. And this is quite an interesting property. So I don't have enough time to go into details about this result, but what it allowed us to do was to prove this characterization theorem, that is our main result, that says that a language of finite trees is recognized by an algebra of bounded complexity if and only if it is a Boolean combination of languages of four simple kinds. So to explain what are these four kinds of languages, I need to define the terms in red. So first, for the unary prefix, look at the tree on the right and start from the root and read what you can see, A, B, and then you meet a symbol that is not unary. So the unary symbol here is AAB. It is the longest word that you read starting from the root before meeting a symbol that is not unary. We write it uprefix here, it's AAB. Now for the first non-unary symbol, this is quite straightforward to define. It is the first symbol that you meet that is not unary. So here in the case of this tree, it is D. Finally, we define what we call the post-bunching symbols of a tree. And here for this tree on the right, its set of post-bunching symbols is A, C, E, J. You can check that's just A, C, E, and J. Finally, what is the language of bounded branching? Well, it is a language for which there is a bound K such that all trees in the language have at most K branches. And now, using this notion, we can state our theorem. So let's say it again. A language of finite trees is recognized by an algebra of bounded complexity if and only if it is a Boolean combination of languages of the following kinds. So first is the language of finite trees whose unary prefix is in a given regular language of words L that we fixed before. We also have the language of finite trees with first non-unary symbol B for some fixed symbol B, the language of finite trees with post-branching symbols B for some fixed parts B of sigma, and any regular language K that is of bounded branching. So this is our main result. I don't have the time either to go into the proof, which is actually quite complex. But this is a proof of concept. It shows that complexity can be used to describe classes of languages that could be interesting. It's simple classes because it is very restricted, but we could still define it as a Boolean combination of some simple languages. And our hope is that complexity may be used to characterize more interesting classes of languages later on. So to sum up what I said in this presentation, first I define this complexity map CA that relates the size of sort X to the size of X. And then I presented to you our results of bounded complexity, which is mainly this characterization theorem on the right. But now, what about polynomial complexity or exponential complexity? Because this is something we've been working on, but we still don't have any definite answers. Not that you could define complexity in an alternative way using what we call orbit complexity. So notice that there is an action of the symmetric group over X over the sort X. This action has some fixed number of orbits, and we could define the orbit complexity of X to be the number of orbits of AX under this action. So this would define another notion of complexity. We are also working on these new other types of complexity. And finally, before I conclude, I would like to mention the fact that this characterization theorem that we obtained for finite trees, we also obtained a similar result for languages of infinite regular trees. So we used a slightly different algebraic structure, but really it was not that much harder. The heart of the proof is really the case of finite trees. And you can prove this case of infinite regular trees with some additional work, but really the main ideas are not there. They are in this characterization result for finite trees. Thank you.